Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
We are talking about Rajasthan and the Congress today. In fact, more the Congress than Rajasthan, because I know that all of you are focused on what is happening right now in Jaipur. Now, think of when you go to a doctor, why should you go to a doctor? Think of when somebody goes to a doctor. Usually, somebody would check your blood pressure, your temperature, etc. Pulse rate, those are your basic vital parameters. Now, as we talk of the Congress politics, let me first give you the fever check and the pulse rate and the blood pressure, etc., for what's happening in Rajasthan. And political equivalent of all these vital parameters is the numbers. So, can Sachin Pilot pull down Ashok Gehlot's state government or not? And can the BJP use him to carry out an operation of the kind that they carried out just the other day, just a few months back in Madhya Pradesh, and before that in Karnataka? Because this is the oft-repeated Operation Kamal. This is done. We know there is an anti-defection law, so people can't just defect from one large party to the other. A small party can defect because a certain percentage have to defect. But when you have a large party at the other end, then you have to get a lot of people to resign. So the overall number in the assembly comes down, because those who resign to defect are then disqualified from being members of the House. So, the overall strength in the House comes down. So, remember what happened in Madhya Pradesh. Madhya Pradesh assembly strength is 230. It was 228 effective when the BJP carried out this operation in March, because two had passed away. Of the 228, Congress party had 114, 114. BJP had 107. Congress party also had the support of two from BSP, one from SP, four for independent. But those guys, as you know, those are floating votes. They go on any sides. They are IRAMs and GRAMs on wheels, on skates. So they can happily, depending on where the incline is, they'll go that side. So don't count them. So basic equation was 114, 107. So what did the BJP do? And what did Jyotiraditya Sindhya do? He left the Congress party. With him, he took away 22 MLAs of the Congress, who, because they left the Congress, had to resign from the assembly because they were disqualified. And with that, the overall number in the House came down. So the overall number in that case with the Congress became 92, and the overall number in the House came down by 22. So in which case, as you can see, BJP's number of 107 was good enough, because the strength of the House came down to 206. From 228. So that was the way the operation was carried out in Madhya Pradesh. And now by-elections will take place for those 22 seats. Now, obviously, those MLAs quit thinking that, all of them are thinking that they will get re-elected with this BJP's support, BJP's ticket, but also with Jyotiraditya Sindhya's support, because they are essentially his loyalists from areas where his word is very strong. Similarly, in Karnataka, a bunch of people had quit the Congress, JD, and they had then contested elections again. Most of them got re-elected. So that method, is it available in Rajasthan? So look at the vital parameters of Rajasthan. Rajasthan is a bit more problematic for the BJP than Madhya Pradesh because of numbers. Because Madhya Pradesh House was 230, effective 228. Rajasthan House is 200, so it is less. Again, Congress in Rajasthan today has 106. We are saying 106 because one is in hospital, he was in hospital when the Rajya Sabha election took place. But if push comes to the shove, he will probably be available. So 107. Once again, if you look at the Congress party support base today, it is 125. Why 125? Because Congress party's two Rajya Sabha candidates got 123 votes in the state assembly. Why? Because one of the two CPM MLAs also voted for them, although the party had decreed that its MLAs will not vote. So he's been suspended by the CPM for a year. But suspension means it continues to be a member of the House. And in case this is a head-to-head with the BJP, it is most likely that the other CPM MLA will also support the Congress. So 123 plus 2, one congressman who's sick, who was in hospital, and one CPM. So 125. There are 13 independents who support the Congress besides its own 107. There are two members of Bharatiya Tribal Party. Now, this is a party of leaders who are rooted in Gujarat. So those leaders have their roots in Gujarat. In fact, in Gujarat, in the areas on the Gujarat-Rajasthan border, that is a tribal zone, and the two seats they won are from that area. So they are so far supporting the Congress party. Then there are two members of RLD. RLD is Ajit Singh's party from Western UP, but they also have some votes in Rajasthan. And as I said, one of CPM. Now, even if we presume that all the independents and the two members of Rashtriya Lok Dal and the two Bharatiya Tribal Party people, that is 13 plus 2, 15 plus 2, 17. All 17, if they shift to the BJP. Unlikely, but suppose all 17 shift, then what does the BJP have? Now, BJP has 71 plus 3. Now, suppose we presume that all these independents also go to BJP. So 71 plus 3, 74, and 13 independents, it becomes 87. Then once again, make a presumption that the two members of RLD also go to the BJP. Although remember, one of those two members of the RLD is a minister in the Gehlot cabinet. But once again, someone else could make you a more important minister. Plus, there could be a sign-on bonus. Let me not call it by the more proper name, which begins the word that begins with B followed by an R. Let me leave it there. So, suppose all of them go, then BJP comes to 89. Now, with 89, how do you get a majority in this house? So, even if BJP gets to 89, to still bring down this government, they have to reduce the numbers in this house to about 170. For that to happen, they will have to break away 30 MLAs from the Congress party. Now, 30 is a lot of MLAs over this base. 22 was a large enough number in Madhya Pradesh. They have done 22 before, but 30 becomes a lot. And even then they are not secure because they need some bit of a cushioning. Because if you are going to be this uncertain or this narrow in your margin of majority, then there are always uncertainties because the other side is not shut out of the deal then. The other side is also in the game. So that is the problem with the BJP right now. And even if they do all this, even if Sachin Pilot could get all these people out, presuming that he does it, I'm not saying that he's going to BJP, but presuming that he does it, how can he ensure then he can get these people elected? That is the promise that Jyotiraditya Sindhya could make to those people, although now they'll face quite a challenge from Digvijay Singh and Kamal Nath. But they were his loyalists. They were from this area. Sachin Pilot does not have an area like that in Rajasthan. So there will be insecurity on these sides. And finally, there is another problem. In Madhya Pradesh, whatever the BJP was doing, they were doing to put their own man in the saddle. That is Shivraj Singh Chauhan. So his party was coherent and Shivraj Singh Chauhan was also keeping them together. The person who came in from outside, Jyotiraditya Sindhya, he wasn't looking for a reward for himself in Madhya Pradesh at that point. He was looking for a reward for himself and his followers in Madhya Pradesh, but for himself in Delhi, Rajya Sabha, and after that, obviously, something else is expected. Now, Sachin Pilot wants to be Chief Minister of Rajasthan. If he's made Chief Minister of Rajasthan, where does that leave Vasundhara Raje? Because think about her. She is a towering BJP leader, not just in Rajasthan, but somebody with a national profile. So Vasundhara Raje has already seen quite a bit of a turf taken away. Because remember, we are a male-dominated polity. Unfortunately, that's a fact. So with nephew coming in, she's lost some leverage within her party. If now in her own state also, Sachin Pilot becomes chief minister, then what is left in the deal for her? And why would then she work so hard to get those 30 MLAs who defect from the Congress re-elected? So those are calculations that those defectors will also have to make. Defectors are smart people. You may like them, you may not like them. They may be immoral, they may lack integrity, but they are not idiots. They are very smart people in the sense that they know what's good for them. And they will take only a calculated risk. They will not jump off the plane without checking the parachute. So those are the limitations that the BJP has in Rajasthan right now. Of course, if you ask the BJP people, they'll say, abhi toh you've seen nothing, picture abhi baki hai. There's a tweet from Shankar Arnimesh, my colleague, who covers the BJP. And he's quoted some BJP leaders as saying, abhi toh picture baki hai, we'll play it like a test match. So session by session, hour by hour, not over by over. So game is not over, game is on. But right now, this is the degree of difficulty in Rajasthan. Now, having said this, vital parameters we talked about and the immediate problem we talked about, Rajasthan. What is the larger issue? The larger issue is the Congress party. Because what's happening in Rajasthan, what happened in Madhya Pradesh before that in Karnataka, these are all symptoms of the larger malaise within the Congress party. Because what happens when you have a problem, when a body has a problem, once again, not you, I don't mean you. Once a human body has a problem in the heart, you don't know, one day your arm can begin to ache, one day something can get blocked in your leg, one day your kidneys can begin to get damaged. So various things happen, but the root cause is somewhere. So the root cause in this case is the state of the Congress party. Now, what is the state of the Congress party? So I wrote a national interest in 2013, of which I'm sharing a copy with you in today's description. There, the headline was One Dynasty Dimming. So what was our point? Our point was that if you look back a decade from then and 17 years from now, almost two decades from now, you will see that what has changed fundamentally in our politics is also something that hasn't. So I'm not nuts. Why am I saying that one thing which has changed most of all is the one that hasn't changed? So what has changed most of all is the strength of the dynasty that rules the Congress party, that is the Gandhi family. What has changed with them is that they simply cannot get votes for their party men and women to get elected. In fact, so much so that they struggle to get votes for themselves. This time, you know very well that even Rahul Gandhi had to seek a safe pasture in Kerala, and he lost his own seat by a sizable number of votes. So the ability of the Congress, of the Gandhi family now to get votes for their own is gone. That's a big disadvantage in politics. And yet what hasn't changed is that their control over the party is not only as strong as before, but probably the strongest ever in the history of Congress party. Because remember, Nehru had people who rebelled against him, who challenged him in the cabinet. Some even left. People of the Congress right left. Indira Gandhi had rebellions within her system. She had the four young Turks, Chandrasekhar, Ramdhan, Mohan Dharia, Krishan Kant. She also had Dinesh Singh doing funny things in her party. After that, Rajiv Gandhi, of course, had B.P. Singh, Arif Muhammad Khan, so many of those problems. Arun Nehru, why forget him? But this Congress has no such problem. I'm not even counting what happened with Narasimha Rao and Sitaram Kesari, because that only proves my point that the power remains with the Gandhi family. So today, what has changed is radically is that they can't get their party men the votes. What has not changed, in fact, has become stronger than before, is their control over the party. And where does this control come from? That's because of the way the Congress party is constructed. It does not have a strong ideology binding people, because most of the leaders in the Congress party are in hereditary positions, including Sachin Pilot, Jyotiraditya Sindhya, Milind Deora, Jitin Prasada. They are all in hereditary positions. So while they may swear by their ideological commitment, that comes later. They want power. That is the most important thing. Now, once you are there for power, then one thing you worry about is one of your peers reaching to the top. So then you get the crabs in the pitcher syndrome, which means any crab that's climbing up, other crabs will pull it down. On the other hand, if you have somebody from the dynasty who you know is entitled to rule the party, but at the same time doesn't threaten you because you are not in a competitive situation with him or her, then you seem to accept it, because the Gandhis in that sense don't threaten anybody. That's why whenever you have a Narasimha Rao or Sitaram Kesari and they give you instructions, nobody follows them. People, or lots of people, defy them and they have trouble. When the Gandhis do some such thing, everybody falls in line because they are your leaders by default. So that is how this contradiction is sustained. And while this goes on, the fact is that almost 15 mini dynasties have come up in India. And if you go to the next level of search, there'll be another 15 and another 15, but this is not a definitive list. But let me just count some. There are the Abdullahs in Kashmir. I'm just going north down to the south. Badals in Punjab. Hudas in Haryana, although Hudas are from Congress, so they are in a different category. And there is Bansilal dynasty in Haryana, which is now represented by my old college mate Kiran Chaudhary. There is the Chautala dynasty in Haryana, which is now split into two. There is the Chandrababu Naidu NTR dynasty in Andhra, Jagan Mohan Reddy YSR dynasty in the same state, KCR in Telangana, Karunanidhi Stalin, Kanimuri in Tamil Nadu. There are the Gowdas in Karnataka, Thakres in Maharashtra, Pawars in Maharashtra, Lalu and Ram Vilas Paswan in Bihar, Naveen Patnaik, he is Biju Patnaik's son, Naveen Patnaik in Odisha, Sangmas in Meghalaya, and so on and so forth. Now, what is important with these dynasties is that all of them have strong vote banks and strong loyalties in small geographies, small but important geographies. What that does is that it doesn't mean that they all have to win an election. Now in Bihar, look at Lalu. Lalu can lose an election. He lost the last couple. He can lose the next election also. But even then, his vote banks will remain intact and he will be the second biggest party after the BJP. So in all these places, these new dynasties have come up who've essentially taken away the Congress party's vote, and Congress party has then become the C team in these states. The latest example of this was Maharashtra, where even the NCP has gone ahead of the Congress party. So while the Congress party is ruled by a dynasty that cannot get you the votes, it has spawned, or it has seen the growth of these 15-20 other mini dynasties whose leaders can build vote banks and keep them together. So the Congress party suffers both ways. That is the reason Congress party largely is in such a mess. Then within the Congress party also, mini dynasties have come up. Again, you can go across the country. Punjab, you have Amrinder Singh. Haryana, you have the Hudas. You have the Surjewalas. Remember, even Randeep Surjewala, who is now the very high-profile spokesperson, is also a dynast. So in Haryana, there are the Surjewalas and the Hudas. That's the reason I said Hudas will come in a different category. There is the Bansilal dynasty. There is the Sheila Dikshit and son. Sheila Dikshit's no more, but the son's there in Delhi. There is Ajay Makan, who's the brother of Lalit Makan's, a nephew of Lalit Makan's. There is Veerbhadra Singh in Himachal Pradesh. Sachin Pilot, Milind Deora, RPN Singh. These are all dynasts, and as was Sindhya. And similarly, others had come up. Narayan Rane had come up from within the Congress in Maharashtra, although he left and he built a dynasty of his own. And this kind of centralized power structure leads to a problem. And we keep telling you that three is a good rule, example of three in journalism. So look at the three examples here. Congress party tried to fight with three regional leaders of its own and failed in each case, and failed in such a way that seems to have lost power in those states permanently. There was Andhra, it fought with YSR's son. Power seems lost permanently. Congress party is wiped out in all capitals in the Andhra Pradesh. Assam, it took on the local, ambitious, powerful, energetic man. Himanta Biswa Sarma, because it leaned on the side of its own mini dynasty there, the Gogois. Once again, the Congress has lost power quite badly there, and we don't know, and Congress party will not know what its future is. If you ask me, I'd say we don't expect the Congress party to make any quick recovery in Assam soon. Then you have Madhya Pradesh. Once again, the Congress party could not handle the ambitions of one of its own leaders, that is Jyotiraditya Sindhia. So this is the problem that the Congress party is having because of its essential disease. All the rest does not matter. Congress party is now a chamber of princes. They are very much like the Indian chamber of princes after Mrs. Gandhi. Rahul Gandhi's grandmother abolished the privy purses and princely benefits in 1969, 1970, 71 in her socialist phase. Rassi jal gayi, par bal nahi kiya. Because they still think they are leaders, but most of them cannot even win their own seats anymore. And you see dynasties, mini dynasties coming up all over. You even have Pranab Mukherjee's two children in politics. So everybody sees this as an opportunity. And once again, if you want to look at the problems the Congress party has had in Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan, there are rival dynasties involved there. Because in Madhya Pradesh, Kamal Nath made sure that his son contested from his seat of Chindwara, his pocket borough, and got elected. The only seat the Congress party won in the state. So his son was set, and he looks at the future of his own son. Digvijay Singh, again on Kamal Nath's side, also fought with Sindhia with Kamal Nath, already had Jaywardhan Singh, his son, made a minister in MP cabinet. In Rajasthan, Ashok Gehlot fielded his son for parliament from his own pocket borough of Jodhpur, lost quite badly by a very large margin, but still is looking after the future of his son. And if Sachin Pilot continues to grow there or continues to be strong there, then it's a problem. So once again, dynasty within dynasty within dynasty. So if it's a case of every man for himself, then why is my dynasty any less deserving of the spoils of politics and power than yours? Particularly when you can't even deliver the votes for me. That is the essential problem with the Congress party.